Transforming Trauma with Jiu-Jitsu. A guide for survivors, therapists, and jiu-jitsu practitioners to facilitate embodied recovery. By Jamie Marich, PhD, and Anna Pirkl, LMFT. Narrated by Marissa Ghavami. Published by North Atlantic Books. This book contains material that may be triggering, including references to self-harm, sexual abuse, or trauma. The practices, figures, and resources can be found in the PDF that comes with this audiobook. To Brendan and Ethan Ryder, my bonus boys, and sons in every sense of the word, thank you for getting me onto the mat. To Alice D. Peebles, aka my adoptive mom, thank you for teaching me that life was worth fighting for. To my awesome daughter and daily sunshine, whenever things are difficult, all I need is a monkey hug, and I know I'll be okay. Anna. Basic Jiu-Jitsu Glossary. The language of jiu-jitsu can feel intimidating at first if you are new to training. In an effort to help survivors feel more confident, we are outlining a variety of basic terms and expressions that you may wish to consult as a quick reference as you read the book. If you are new to jiu-jitsu and decide to begin training, learning this vocabulary will empower you with the skills to communicate on the mat with your partner. Our goal is to help you feel more knowledgeable, to strengthen your voice, and to help you communicate effectively with your partners and instructors. More specifics on these terms are given in chapters 5 and 6. For additional jiu-jitsu terminology, we recommend the Almost Complete Jiu-Jitsu Dictionary, which can be found at https://jiu-jitsu-x.com/v/ju/jitsu/dictionary/. Armlock or armbar. Submissions, defined later on, in which you position an opponent's arm in relation to your body in such a way that you have the possibility of hyperextending their elbow and/or over-rotating their shoulder. Sometimes pressure on the joint is all you need to bring the person to yield or submit to your authority and stop what they were doing. Unfortunately, in cases in which a person has a high pain tolerance or is not registering pain, due to drugs and/or alcohol, injury of the limb might be the only option to neutralize their attack. Back mount slash hooks in. A position in which you attach yourself to the back of the opponent. Your torso is connected to their back, with your legs and arms wrapped around them for control. You put your hooks in by placing your legs inside your opponent's thighs and using your arms to attach to and control their upper body. If you are practicing this with a male partner, be careful to be mindful in placing your hooks in so you do not unintentionally heel them in their genitals. Base. The stability of your connection to the ground. If you have good base, it means it is difficult to push, pull, or move you. Base is a way of positioning your body to maximize your ability to apply and absorb force. Base is covered more extensively in Chapter 1. Belt rank. Many schools of jiu-jitsu have a belt ranking system, from least experienced to most, as follows. Stripes indicate gradient levels of progress within a particular belt category. 1. White. 1 to 4 stripes. 2. Blue. 1 to 4 stripes. 3. Purple. 1 to 4 stripes. 4. Brown. 1 to 4 stripes. 5. Black. 1 to 6 degrees. 6. 7th degree black belt. Coral belt is awarded, also known as master. 7. 9th degree black belt. Red belt is awarded. Grand master, of which there are very few in the world. Some programs have additional differentiated belts. For children under 18, yellow stripe, solid yellow, orange stripe, solid orange, green stripe, solid green. Women, pink. Self-defense, street fighting. Combative belt, white with blue stripe. Break falling. Specifically in jiu-jitsu, this typically refers to a controlled fall, from standing to being on the ground. The goal is to learn how to take the energy of the fall and disperse it away from your trunk, head, and neck, and instead distribute it through the arms and legs. The technique often looks like a rolling slap to the ground. In this way, the person works to protect their body and especially their head and neck from injury. Clinch. A technique outlined in more depth in Chapter 5, intended to help protect from powerful punches. Using it, you get in so close that your opponent's punching becomes low impact and ineffective in knocking you out. It is essentially a position similar to a really tight hug. Close guard. A position in which the practitioner traps an opponent in between their legs by wrapping their legs around the opponent and crossing their ankles behind their opponent's back. This can help to prevent them from standing up. At the same time, arms are often working to control the opponent's head and to keep them close to avoid severe punches. The goal is for the practitioner to practice their ability to use their legs and arms to control an opponent while the practitioner is on their back with the opponent between their legs. Footlocks. A submission, defined later, in which you position an opponent's foot in relation to your body in such a way that you have the possibility of injuring it or their ankle. Sometimes pressure on the joint is what you need to bring the person to yield or submit to your authority and stop what they were doing. Unfortunately, in cases in which a person has a high pain tolerance or is not registering pain due to drugs and/or alcohol, injury of the limb might be the only option to neutralize their attack. Footlocks are often only taught to more advanced students or in early competitive sport gyms. If you are sparring in a new gym or with a new partner, be sure to highlight what you do and don't know, and that you want to go slow until you are more experienced. If you are both moving slowly, you can spot if your foot is trapped and tap early. Gi versus no gi. A gi is a uniform for jiu-jitsu training, sometimes referred to as a kimono. A gi is typically a heavy cotton jacket, drawstring trousers, and a belt indicating your color rank. The term gi also refers to practice in which the participants are wearing gi. For example, today is gi day, or today is no gi day. Some say that gi is more realistic because in a real fight on the street, people often grab your clothing. Gi helps you learn how to escape and defend against submissions in which clothing is used to submit. Gi also allows you to practice using an attacker's clothing against them. No gi is typically leggings, shorts, and a rash guard top. No gi or rash guards help you learn to control your opponent and submit them without using clothing. No gi also prepares you for an attack in warmer weather, where jackets and thicker clothing will not necessarily be available, eliminating some submissions. Preparing for defense against a person without a shirt, for example, is also useful and can feel similar to the rash guard top worn in no-gi trainings. Good guy slash bad guy. Jiu-jitsu slang often used during instruction to indicate which partner is taking which role in training. The bad guy can often be referred to as the aggressor or the opponent. Yet, in talking to many instructors, we have found a highly applicable and usable counterpoint for good guy. Many instructors emphasize that because good guy, bad guy is very quick and easy to articulate, the terms are easy to apply when instructing. Be prepared to hear these terms in a school, even as inclusive and gender-neutral language is becoming more widespread. And we personally support this movement. If the terminology bothers you, bring it up with your instructor, especially if you have any viable alternatives to propose. Attacker slash defender is the best alternative that we have found, and we use it often throughout the book. Although less common, in some jiu-jitsu settings, the Japanese terms torite, partner, specifically the executor or connector of technique, and aite, partner, receiver, are used. many variations on these terms exist across other Japanese martial arts. Grips: sea grip and monkey grip. Sea grip and monkey grip are two different ways to use your hands to grip onto something. Depending on the scenario and whether you are needing to push or pull, one has more strength than the other. In order to conceptualize these grips, take your hand and hold all your fingers together and straight up, as if you were going to high-five someone. Keeping them all glued together, bend your fingers forward, together. This is the monkey grip. The difference between monkey grip and C grip is the direction of the thumb. In C grip, your fingers keep this same position, but rather than being lined up with your other fingers, your thumb comes around from the opposite direction to grab something. This is the more common everyday grip we use to pick something up, for example. You would use a particular grip for many different reasons. Good instructors explain why one is better than the other for a particular technique. C grip is also referred to as C clamp. Guard or in guard. The practitioner is in the supine position with their legs wrapped around their partner. In the event that you are practicing a move with your partner and they are the aggressor, they might say, "For this move, I am in your guard." This means that you are on your back on the ground and they kneel to get in between your legs. The move is then executed from in guard. Indicator: a signal that something is coming or a sign that you will need to prepare for or engage in a certain technique. For example, if your instructor or partner wants you to practice the wrist release, the indicator would be them grabbing your wrist. Leverage, or alavanca in Portuguese, is one of the core concepts of jiu-jitsu. In jiu-jitsu, we use our limbs and torso like mechanical levers, pushing and pulling to put an opponent in a compromising position. Leverage is a key factor in what allows a smaller person to defeat a bigger opponent. If you position yourself in the right way, it is your bones that are holding back an opponent versus your muscle strength. Consider two same-weight children sitting on a seesaw. The further out one child sits, the more force and control they exert over the other. Jiu-jitsu teaches us to use our body position to create a mechanical advantage that often works over considerably larger opponents. Mount: a position in which the good guy is sitting astride with a leg on either side of the opponent's stomach. When students are just beginning to learn these techniques, it is important to have the bad guy on the bottom, expressing how much weight is okay.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.